here in James's office. I don't know if he knows that or not, but he will in a minute. We are coming at you with week 3 on fear. So I'm going to open us up in prayer, and then we're going to talk a little bit about fear and the opposite of, and what we do as a response to, and all sorts of things. The Lord has been so good this week and just led me in all sorts of ways, and I'm very excited to share with y'all.
Awesome.
So let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this night, just that we can come and have this time to talk to our teens about fear, and God, just to be real with them and be honest and discuss your word. Father, I'm so thankful for your word and just the way that it guides us and the examples that are laid out in it, Father. I can't get over your kindness, and the more we talk about fear, the more I see your kindness, and the more I see your goodness and your faithfulness, and just the more I can be thankful for that, Father God. I just pray that as we enter into this time, that you would just glorify this conversation, God. Let it be all about who you are, and not about the words that we speak, and not about the goofiness that is in us, God, but just about who you are, your goodness and your graciousness, and just why we don't have to fear, and that you are our rock, Father. All these things, I just ask in your name, amen.
I know who she's calling goofy. I'm always real serious.
Shut the front door. You don't even mean it.
Go ahead.
Okay. So, this week, for real, Lori walked in just a minute ago after we have already discussed this lesson multiple times, and I just looked at her and said, so, we're going to take a little different route, and we're going to add some onto this, and what do you got? And so this is all very fresh, very raw. The Lord just today has been speaking to me in just some of the weirdest ways that I'm so thankful for, through podcasts, which of course I listen to podcasts all the time. That's so weird. Yeah, that's my thing. In the car, that's what I listen to. But also just in the craziest ways, I cleaned out a storage shed this morning with my family that was messed up in the storm, and just going through and seeing my childhood things and seeing just what the Lord has done in me, and how fear is still a part of my story, but that it doesn't have the grip on me that it once did. And so it just kind of led me a little more. So we're to a little different place, but we are going to talk about excuses, the faithfulness of the Lord, and courage, and how because of God's faithfulness, we can have courage. So, of course, I'm going to start with definitions because I love them.
Yes, she does.
I do. It drives the point home. I think it just helps level the playing field. We all know we're on the same page and talking about the same thing. So, I took notes on the back of the bulletin, so sorry. Excuse is an attempt to lessen the blame, release from a duty or requirement, or a rationalization that we make to ourselves about people, events, and circumstances. Excuses are invented reasons that we create to defend our behavior, to postpone taking action, or simply as a means of neglecting responsibility. So this stepped on all 10 of my toes. So all of them this week as I was looking this up. But then I just started thinking of times that excuses were made in the Bible, and how a lot of times it was out of fear. Or fear is in the story somehow. So we have some stories we're going to look at. And we'll just kind of see where it goes. I want for y'all to know that Lori is very organized and Lissa is very unorganized. Last week, Lori was the main teacher and I was the sidekick. This week, I am the main teacher and she's the sidekick. So welcome to unorganized chaos. And we'll see what happens.
I'm not going to fear.
No, it's a test. No, I don't mean
friendship.
Maybe. I just really thought I had a plan. I thought I had a plan, and then I came in with my old bulletin, and she came in with a notebook. So, anyways.
No notes from her.
No notes. So, here we go. We're going to just see how the Lord moves. Okay, so I want look at, this is kind of an odd story to look at for excuses, and I understand that, but we're going to look at it anyways. We're in John chapter 5, and it's the healing at the pool. So I'm going to kind of recap this a little bit for you. So there's this pool outside of Jerusalem, and occasionally, for whatever reason, the water would swirl on its own. And so I need to put the pen down before I put myself in the eyeball. So people would get into the water while it was swirling, and it was said to have healing powers.
A whirlpool, if you will.
A whirlpool, there you go. And so they would get into this while it was whirling in the pooling, and it would heal them. So these people are there, and Jesus and some disciples roll up onto the scene, which is just always a cool story. But I'm going to start in chapter 5, verse 3. It says, "Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, 'Do you want to get well?'" And so this is where the excuses start. And it doesn't say that this is out of fear. So let me just say that first off. It doesn't say that. But reading this story, it makes me think that it's partly the fear of the unknown. All he's ever known for 38 years is not being able to walk. So the thought of suddenly being able to walk, while it's exciting, that's also probably terrifying. Like, I can't even imagine. So in verse 7, so Jesus had just said, "Do you want to get well?" And in verse 7, he says, "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me get into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone always gets down ahead of me." And then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." And at once the man was cured, and he picked up his mat and walked. So obviously that's miraculous that Jesus healed him. And I do not want to take
away. Without the pool.
Without the pool. Yeah, absolutely. And I don't want to take away from that part of the story at all. That is the purpose of the story. That is the point of it. And it is beautiful. It is beautiful just as the Lord designed it.
Oh, yeah.
But I want to look at that excuse that he just started building, that he had no one help him in there, or every time he tried. Well, it's just interesting that you could be there for that long and have never figured out a way to get to the water when it was stirred, or found other people to help. I don't know. It's just these excuses that he started building. So then
it's his fear of giving up his excuse.
Right.
To live.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh. How often does that happen? Like, we have used something all of this time, and when it gets taken away, we don't know how to function.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have used it as our excuse for so long.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a big thing for him.
It really is. Man.
Yeah.
So this is a little off topic. Oh, I'm going to go here. This is just about me. I get really hooked on looking for something. Like, I really wanted a gold tea kettle. Or like bronze tea kettle. Because it would look cute in my kitchen. Really, I wanted rose gold, if we're being honest. Okay, so I wanted this. I thought it would be so cute. And so I looked and looked and looked. And that was all I wanted to complete my kitchen. And then I found one, and I got it, and it's at my home. It's been there for like 3 years, and I love it, and I use it all the time. But it's like, as soon as I got that, then it was like something else, something else. And I think, well, for me, let's just be honest, that is an excuse, and it's an excuse to shop, because I have my own personal struggle with that. But it's...
We're not talking about that today.
No, not today. Maybe next week. No, I'm just kidding. Definitely not.
Never
going to talk about that. No, I'm just kidding. But it's the same with our excuses outside of that. Like, we hold on to something, and then once someone tears it down, then we build another. Or that's like me finding the item that I'm looking for, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Anyways...
I've had my round with excuses. I've learned my lesson, I hope.
So the next one, do you have Exodus pulled up, or did you want me to look at that?
I have it right here.
Okay, so the next one we're going to talk about is Moses. So Moses, he liked some excuses too.
Yeah, so kind of setting things up here in chapter 3, we see Moses, the shepherd, out tending the flock of his father-in-law, old Jethro. I love that name.
He's
over there, and he goes to the far side of the wilderness and is at Horeb, which is the mountain of God. So guess who he's going to see there?
Dun, dun, dun.
I mean, it's his own mountain, so. So it says that there the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire. So this is the burning bush that you've probably heard of before. And as a child, kind of that burning bush, we've sing songs about it. And so this is where Moses starts getting called, right? Mm-hmm. And he hears his name from the bush, and he goes over to kind of see what's going on. It's already looking kind of weird. It's not burning up, but it's on fire. And he answers, and he tells him, and the Lord tells him not to come any closer. And the Lord kind of lays out this plan to him, and he tells him, he says, I have seen my people in Egypt, the people that you were born with, the people you were raised with, for the first 40 years of his life. Mm-hmm. I've heard them crying out in misery in Egypt, and because of that, I'm going to rescue them, and I'm going to use you to do it. Right. And Moses didn't like that idea, did he? No. So he had a lot of excuses, which I feel the boy. I understand it. Mm-hmm. But the first thing he says in verse 11 of chapter 3 of Exodus, he says, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh?" Keeping in mind, this is the household that he had grown up in. He knew all of their ways, but he says, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" And God responds to him, and he says, "I will be with you," which is what we talked about last week of, you know, when we give our fear over, he tells us not to because he's going to be there with us. So he promises us to walk with us in that. And he gives him a sign of what that's going to look like. And then Moses comes up with excuse number two. And he says, what if I go to the Israelites and say to them, "The God of your fathers has sent me to you"? And they ask, "Well, what's his name?" Yeah, that's so typical of us. Well, if you know him so well, what's his name? then what am I supposed to tell him? Like, oh. And God gives him his name, and he says, "I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you." So he has responded to excuse number two. And then he goes on, and he tells him to tell him that he is to the Israelites, "The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, has sent me to you." And then we go on a little bit further, and Moses gives another excuse. He is full of them, right?
He really is.
He says, "What if they," this is the first part of chapter 4, and it says, "What if they don't believe me or listen to me and say, 'The Lord didn't appear to you?'" And so then the Lord gives him some signs, and he does that through the staff in his hand. He's like performing signs in front of them. And he goes on, and I mean, that, I think, I want to say that would have been enough for me, like, to see God do these crazy signs with me. Like, ooh, I can do a magic show. I think that would have been enough for me, but having lived in the disobedience of excuses, I know that that's probably not true.
Well, so I want to say that about myself, too, but then really thinking about it, like, I think the others would have convinced me more than this, because I can definitely see how they would be like, "Oh, we have magicians and we have, you know, all of these things."
But I think that was more for the Egyptians than the Israelites.
Well, like, probably.
I think they, because their hope and their trust was in the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Just being like around that, I don't know. It just seems like, not that it's not miraculous, because it totally is, but, and like, just the fact that the bush is on fire and it hasn't burned. Like, let's not negate that. Like,
I don't, I don't think you're seeing what I'm getting at here, Mowgli. But we go into one of his last excuses before he just is kind of blown away. And that is in chapter 4, verse 10. And it says, Moses says to the Lord, "Pardon your servant. I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue." So he's like, I have a speech problem. I can't speak to these people. I cannot speak well. And basically says, and you know it. Like,
you made me.
You can't negate that. You know that. You've heard me speak to you. And so I think that that was interesting. And do you want to pick up with the Lord's response there?
Yeah, so I love this part. Well, I love this whole story really, but the Lord said to him, "Who gave human beings their mouths? Who makes them deaf or mute? Who gives them sight or makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak and will teach you what to say." But, because there's always a but, Moses said, "Pardon your servant, Lord. Please send someone else." Like, I hate his disobedience here, but I love his honesty.
He's like, done at this point, like, he is not taking any more excuses, so please, I'm done. I'm not going.
Please just don't. Please.
Somebody else, like, I've tried to be about gracefully. You're not having it, so I'm just going to tell you like it is. I don't want to.
Tag you're it, but there's no one to tag. So.
Somebody else.
But
see the sheep here? You can do the same through the goat.
But the Lord's anger burned against Moses, which is just interesting considering the burning bush that's still happening, okay?
Right. There is one person that I would not want angry with me, you know, Big Karen.
Oh,
there is. Definitely the Lord.
Amen.
I don't want him angry with me.
I don't either. But the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, "What about your brother, Aaron, the Levite? I know he can speak well. He is already on his way to meet you, and he will be glad to see you. You shall speak to him and put the words in his mouth, and I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth, and as if you were God to him. But take this staff in your hand so you can perform the signs with it." So me reading this story, what I picture is as a little kid with a stick and an ant trail and like squishing them. You didn't do that? All right, well, that just shows how weird I am. But just like killing these little ants because they're in a trail, like Moses just keeps firing them out and he just keeps squishing them.
It is what it is.
The kid on Toy Story did it. I can't be that weird. I can't be the only one that did this. Sid, I guess he was a bad guy, though. Sid, he was mean. Oh, never mind. I didn't do that as a kid. But I've seen it happen in Toy Story with Sid. That's what I think of, though. It's just something like that. Or, I don't even know what else. That's actually what I picture. But he's just, like, squashing his excuses one after another.
Oh, like, now with, I get it. Okay. I was like, where is she going with this?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were picking up. I was putting on the whole time.
Our film crew, I feel like they're right tracking with me, not with you.
Did you not get it either?
Not until you said that.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Well, now that we clarified, he's just squashing the excuses one after another.
You were saying ants. So I was like,
Well, yeah, just like I would the ants as they're in a line. Okay. Maybe someone followed. Or maybe they didn't, but we've clarified now, so we're good. Anyways, but the Lord's just knocking him down, and, like, just, I love, too, that he doesn't let him out of it. He's not like, okay, good bargaining, you don't have to go. But he's like, you're going, this is going to happen, but I, as a faithful Lord, even though I'm angry at you, will be gracious to you, and we'll send you help. We'll send you a buddy. And, so I love that. But back to the root here. He was fearful. He was fearful that he would be embarrassed. He was fearful that they wouldn't believe him. He was fearful that he would be rejected by the people who raised him. He was there were so many things he was fearful of, and so he just kept building up excuse after excuse. So we're going to look at Jeremiah. So in Jeremiah 1:4 is the call of Jeremiah. So Jeremiah had a big calling, and he was called to go and correct false prophets was his role. So he was a prophet that was going to say that other people were saying things that weren't actually from God.
He was calling them out.
Yeah, he was. So
taking names.
He didn't actually want to do that, surprisingly. I mean, like, who wouldn't want to do that? Anyway,
Jeremiah,
right, or anybody else here, really. But so Jeremiah 1:4, it says, "The word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Alas, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak. I am too young." It's like he took a lesson from Moses.
Yeah.
And he says, "But the Lord said to me, do not say I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord." And then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said, "I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant." The word of the Lord came to me and said, where do you see, Jeremiah? Or what do you see, Jeremiah? He said, I see the branch of the almond tree. And then it goes on with this conversation between him and the Lord, which is just such a cool and like intimate conversation. It's just so cool to read. So you should really look into that. But his response says, I don't know how to speak, I'm too young. Mm-hmm. And I want for this to mean something to you, because he said he's not too young. He told Jeremiah that, and that he would put words in his mouth. And we are on such a different side of this, that we have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is living in us and is working in and around us constantly. And so for him to tell Jeremiah to not be fearful because he's giving him words, like, how much more does that mean for us? Like, the Lord is on our side just like he was on Jeremiah's. The Lord is putting words in our mouth just like he did for Jeremiah.
And I think just I was thinking about that and thinking about 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, where Paul, a person who knew these scriptures and he knew the Old Testament, he says he was a Jew among Jews.
Yeah.
And he, knowing that in the past this had been an excuse that had been used over and over again by youth, by young men who were called to do something, in verse 11 before
and
that, he says,
by other people about people of the Lord. Like, just thinking about David. Like, David didn't necessarily use that as an excuse, but everyone around him tried to place that on him.
But he tells him, he says, command and teach these things. But then he comes right behind it, telling him, do not let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech and conduct, in love and faith and in purity. So he, before Timothy could even use that as an excuse, he kind of jumps in there with
like,
that.
He's
like, I've seen this before, read this story before, and I want to make sure that you don't follow that example of excuses. Realize that your youth has nothing to do with your ability to serve God and to carry out his commands.
Yeah.
I think that's
and what
exciting.
The word is, or the Bible is the inspired word of God. In Jeremiah, God is saying this. This is a real story about a real person named Jeremiah, and God is putting this thought, giving this word to him. This is Timothy and Paul are real people, and the Lord inspired those words as well. And if he's inspiring that word throughout, like, it's true today. And his word is true today, no matter what. So that's true in our lives today too, because I'm going to classify myself as young. But anyways, thank you. So now I want to talk about the next aspect. So this is a little longer than I planned for it to be. But I want to talk about courage, because I don't think that we should talk about this and not talk about courage. So, another definition. Courage is the ability to do something that frightens one. So, it's not being afraid. It's just doing it afraid, which we talked about some last week.
Yeah.
But
Do it scared.
So, but courage is, that's what it means, is to do something that frightens you. And so I started thinking about the courageous people of the Bible. And so we're just going to kind of go through some stories, and we're not going to read them. We're just going to talk about them. And I want you guys to look some of them up and just check out these courageous people. But the people that we've talked about, first off, obviously Moses was scared, but Moses did it anyways. I want you to know that he didn't do it anyways just to do it. He did it because he knew that the faithfulness of the Lord was with him. Yeah. And the Lord was like, I'm mad at you, but you need to go, and I'm going to send you help. I mean, there was a reverent fear of the Lord in that, too.
Exactly. And that's what I was going to say, is it tells that he tells them not to fear. It never says that he took their fear away.
Right. Ooh, that's good.
But it does say that he promises to be with them in the midst of that fear.
Yeah.
That he is going into the pit with them.
Mm-hmm.
And so.
Yeah, for sure. And then Jeremiah, like, we didn't talk about it, but Jeremiah does it. He does the thing, okay? Like, he says he doesn't want to, but the Lord puts the words in his mouth. Yeah, and there's a whole book. And Jeremiah calls them all out. And he does what he's supposed to do, and he works for the Lord. He works fervently for the Lord. But then some other things, too. I want to talk about the three little Hebrew boys.
So when we refer to the three little Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego,
yes,
as we were talking about that there, they also have their actual Hebrew names, which
right,
are different than that, but in the book of Daniel.
So we talked about it last week, but I don't feel like you can talk about courage and not talk about this. Also, it feels weird to talk about the burning bush and not talk about this.
Yeah.
Because in both is fire, and in both things don't burn. And that's odd, in case you missed it. That doesn't really happen. But it did both times, and the Lord's hand was so strongly in both. And so, but they were courageous. They stood up for the Lord. Not because they weren't afraid. Not because they wanted to be thrown into a pit of fire. Like, I don't think anyone chooses that without fear, you know, but they did it. They knew what the consequences were, and they said, no, we're not going to serve your God, because our God is better. And then I think about Mary and Joseph. Mary had to be scared. I mean, an angel just came to her and said, hey, we got to put a baby in your belly. Like, the Lord's going to do this, so you're good. Just keep going with your life, and you're going to deliver a baby in a few months. Like, that's terrifying, but she did it. She did it anyways, and she birthed the Savior of the world. And then Joseph, to think, what in the world happened here? Like,
engaged
to her. What's going to happen to us? What does this look like? What's the, but courage. He was frightened, but he did it anyways because the Lord spoke to him, and, the Lord spoke to him. And then I think of Nehemiah. That's what me and Lori were just talking about this before. Nehemiah, everything about him was courageous, really. His role was to taste the food and the drink before it went to the king to see if it was poison or not. So if someone brought it to him and he drank it and he died, then the king wouldn't partake of it. So that in and of itself was courageous. But then he saw that his hometown was the protective wall had been broken down around it. And so he prayed over his town, and the king actually let him go and sent him with people and to rebuild it. And he had so many people coming against him for that.
Oh yeah.
I mean, the wall was down for a reason. People wanted in. People wanted to take over the city. And he went and he built the wall. And I can't imagine that at some point in there wasn't fear. But he knew that the Lord's plan was better. And he chose that. And then we can't talk about courage and choosing to do the hard things without talking about Jesus.
truth.
We can't. Jesus came to the earth. He lived a sinless life. And he died on the cross, and he chose it, and he chose it willingly.
Yeah.
But I want to talk about the Garden of Gethsemane. But Jesus went to the garden to pray, and he literally prayed, Lord, if there's any way, if there's any other way, please take it. But if not, then your will be done. If not, your will be done. And he prays this, and he was sweating blood, and there was fear in him. There was fear in him. He wouldn't be begging for that if there wasn't fear in him, but he did it anyways. Like, what a mark, not only of grace and love, but of courage beyond belief. Courage, I guess, not beyond belief. Beyond comprehension, really. I can't imagine having that much courage. I'm a scaredy cat, so that's crazy for me to even think of. But just to know that the Lord had courage like that, that Jesus had that courage. There's so many more courageous people throughout the Bible. I know. It's full of them. The disciples, the apostles, they were beaten and imprisoned, and they did the work of the Lord anyways. And so I just think if we're going to talk about fear, we have to talk about courage. Because when it comes to sharing the gospel, that's an easy thing for us to be fearful of. And talking to other people, it's easy to be fearful of. But we have to understand that the faithfulness of the Lord and the goodness and the kindness and the graciousness of the Lord is there with us, just like it was with all these other people. And we have to do it anyways. We have to do it courageously.
And do it scared.
Do it scared.
And the reality is this. Please don't let your fear keep you from having a relationship with Christ.
Yeah.
That is not my biggest fear, but that is something that...
It burdens us.
It does. It burdens me. It hurts my heart to believe that a fear, and fear of the unknown, and fear of what is he going to call me to if...
Yeah.
...keeps our students and our friends and our community from having a relationship with Christ. And I would never want that to be you.
Yeah, for sure. And then just to think about these people too, like, their life looked different after those moments of courage. But to be in the will of the Lord, like, how much better was their life? How much more profitable was it? How much more fruitful?
When my sister and brother-in-law were getting ready to go on the mission field, we were at camp, and there was a pastor, and he had been a missionary for years. And one of the statements that he said that has just resonated with me was that the safest place in the world is in the center of God's will. Even if it's in the most dangerous place on the earth, if you're in the center of where God wants you to be, that is the safest place. And that has always been in the back of my mind.
It may be the eye of the storm, but it's the eye.
Exactly. And he promises not necessarily to take us out of it, but to be in it with us. And I just love that.
Yeah.
So. All right. Okay. Well, we love you guys. And wish you were here.
We so wish we could be with you guys. I really want to hug some people. Like, I've been missing hugging everyone and just seeing your faces.
I want to send you a high five and an air hug.
She just did that.
I did.
And she meant it.
I certainly did.
We love y'all, babe. Please text us, call us, reach out to us.
I like you, girl.
Yes. Share with your friends.
Yeah.
Pass it along to people that you think might be encouraged. But we love y'all. We hope you were encouraged. And we'll talk to you soon.
Bye, guys.